Margaret Downey is the founder and president of the Free Thought Society, a national organization promoting the growth of local free thought groups, as well as the Anti-Discrimination Support Network. I actually met Margaret at an AAI convention in Montreal a few years back, and she said I was handsome, so that was it. We were friends for life. I'm so glad that she was able to make it here. I'm very pleased to introduce the lovely Margaret Downey.
Thank you. Hello. So we're going to test the microphone a little bit. Is where we do it good? Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. And thank you so much for inviting me to speak at this wonderful conference. And congratulations to the conference organizers for putting on such a successful event. Congratulations. I titled my presentation, Every Freethinker Has a Story, because my goal this afternoon is to inspire conference attendees to think about writing or talking about a journey story. A journey story that can capture how thinking freely became a very valuable thing in your life. For 20 years, I've promoted the notion that non-theist journey stories should be shared. And I'm very proud that many journey stories about freedom of thought have been published in the Free Thought Society newsletter. And samples of those stories are appearing on the screen as I speak. Journey stories can help develop a better understanding of the non-theist community. Journey stories are important because the written word enables us to connect emotionally to others. We can present hundreds of logical arguments and facts concerning why people should not be attached to religious or superstitious beliefs, but let's face it, religious belief is more emotional than rational. Non-theists can debate the validity of a scripture or argue the existence of God, but we cannot deny a person's personal religious experience. When a religious person tells their story about how God has worked some kind of perceived miracle, or how God somehow blessed, transformed, lifted, and encouraged them, well, we just can't argue against that. It's their story. Some religious folks even knock on doors to tell their story. Now, we non-theists have not used that type of proselytizing approach, but we can and we should present a realistic, natural world perspective through the telling of our own journey stories. Now, during my time with you today, I hope to inspire you to think about your experiences and find the passion to convey your journey through writing or in just simple conversations. I suggest that you ask yourself a few simple questions and then brainstorm with others about your experiences. You know, you might want to think about personal circumstances and situations that had an influence on you. You might recall humorous experiences and situations, or you might be compelled to write about a specific dramatic experience. A good journey story should also convey your profound insights and your worldly observations. Remember that only you can convey a very special message to a reader. Ask yourself if you have a unique outlook and try to remember social issues and historical events that were exposed to you as you grew up. Everyone in this room has experienced something special, something different, and something exceptional. So recall people and events that shaped or influenced you. And take the opportunity to describe to the reader how you learned about the non-theist community and began going to conferences such as this one in Kamloops, Canada. If you want your journey story published and read, you must bring to light some personal experiences So think about unusual obstacles that you've had to overcome. For example, you may have had economic hardships, or you may have had family or physical difficulties. And after thinking and remembering, you must make a commitment to be honest to your readers. Don't hold back any secrets. Disclosure of difficulties and talking about how you were able to overcome them without God, prayer, or superstition will surely reveal great insight and strength of character. And there is power in your story. Your story might get noticed by someone searching for their own philosophical home. And a reader can find your story inspirational and may be able to relate to it more than you can think they do. And you might want to include a little, and I'm reluctant to use this word, testimony about non-theism. You know, the religious community makes use of testimonials all the time. Church settings are used to bear witness to the existence of God. And the reason that testimonies are encouraged is because there is no hard evidence for a God other than the people saying so. Non-theist journey stories confirm that rational thinking and the examination of facts will lead to a more honest and better life, a life free from religious intrusions and harmful dictates. Now, I'm not encouraging you to go door to door to tell your story, but I am encouraging you to take the opportunity to inspire potential readers to learn more about humanism, atheist concerns, and the value of thinking freely. National groups are always looking for a good article to print, and the magazines you see on the screen are read by a lot of people. If you consider yourself an atheist, I encourage you to submit your article to magazines that like that specific identity. Now, if you call yourself a humanist, there's a magazine that absolutely loves to get submissions using the term humanism. And I, of course, recommend that you give the Free Thought Society newsletter the first opportunity to publish your story. We accept all philosophical descriptions that authors like to use. Another reason to write your story is that it can become your legacy. Now, one word of caution, before you submit your story to any publication, it's very important that you fact check. And even though you think you might remember something correctly, you may not. The brain changes things over the years. Fact-checking may simply be asking a relative to look over your essay and comment about missing or wrong details. You don't want to innocently convey a historical incident from a child's point of view and get the facts wrong and then turn off your reader. So stay credible, even if you must re-remember an incident that you want to convey. And I also suggest that you seek to place your reader into your story. The use of carefully worded descriptions and associated emotions will pull someone into your story. But if you're not a writer, then I hope you will just think about what you would say if someone asked you, how did you become a non-theist? And everyone in this room should be prepared to answer that question in a concise, informative, and well thought out manner. You don't want to waste one precious moment having to stop and think about your response on the spot. The question could be answered in a form of a 1 minute elevator speech or during a lengthy dinner conversation. The point is that we must be prepared to represent our philosophy in a way that will capture the hearts and minds of those who are interested enough to have asked. Now, as an example of how a story can be weaved together, I'm going to share my own journey story with you today. I was born with an overabundance of wonder and curiosity. And then this is a photo of me at 6 months of age. And what's interesting about this photo is that I'm pointing to the photographer just as he pointed at me. And I didn't know it then, but the photographer caught me displaying an important evolutionary component. Mirroring is the behavior in which one person copies another person, usually while in a social interaction with them. And mirroring includes the miming of gestures, language, expressions, accents, and many other aspects of communication. Mirroring is said to be a very important social interaction that helps humans become empathetic animals, eh? Learning more about mirroring made me very proud of that picture, even though I have no memory of posing for it. Now, I also have no memory of a childhood incident that my family would reference to each time I would question what I was being told. When I was quite young, I was given a doll that supposedly spoke, and the doll spoke only one word, mama. The doll spoke this word only when it was turned over. I decided to find out exactly how that doll could speak. Removal of the doll's head and the tearing open of the front seam of the doll's body revealed a sound mechanism called a voice box. The doll was destroyed, but the mystery was solved. And the incident caused my parents to learn that their little girl would always investigate the unknown. So when my younger sister was born, my parents would not allow me to hold her. They feared that in an attempt to find out how the baby cried, I would just rip her open to discover the source of her sounds. Now, as a child, I was plagued with asthma. It's chronic. And frankly, I barely survived my toddlerhood and my infancy even. The trauma of illness after illness enables me to remember my childhood experiences vividly. At 5 years of age, an evangelical tent revival pulled into town. I'd been ill for years, and many doctors were unable to improve my condition. And desperate to save my life, my mother thought it was time to get a little help from Jesus. And the preacher at the tent revival was none other than Oral Roberts. His hellfire and damnation style of preaching was frightening to most adults, so you can well imagine the fear I had as my mother pushed me toward the center aisle to wait for that hands-on healing. The air in the tent was filled with dust from the ground, and the oxygen was mixed with cigarette and cigar smoke. It was a hot summer day on top of everything else, and there I was, a little five-year-old, inhaling all that unhealthy air into my asthmatic lungs. By the time I got to the stage and stood in front of Oral Roberts, I was out of breath and hyperventilating. And I took one look at the people in the audience who were singing and dancing and praising Jesus, and I fainted into a heap of petticoats and lace. And my next memory was that of being inside an ambulance wearing an oxygen mask. I was rushed to a nearby hospital to get the real care that I needed. The laying of hands on my sick body didn't cure me of asthma. The revival tent ordeal actually made my condition much worse. And I lived in an oxygen tent at a hospital for about 6 months after that incident. And each day, I was visited by doctors and nurses who administered medications. They gave me shots, and they regulated the flow of oxygen. And I vividly recall my mother asking a group of nuns to come and pray by my bedside. I was very ill, but the vision of those praying nuns is embedded in my brain. My mother stood among those four nuns who were dressed in their black and white habits, and they were murmuring and chanting in unison. And I remember thinking, where are my doctors and nurses? These crazy ladies are in the way. Help me! I thought the nuns were actually blocking my bed and preventing me from getting the real help that I needed. So I asked them to leave me alone, and I actually cried for my doctors and my shots and my nurses. I guess you can say that asking the nuns to go away was my first rejection of religious belief. Well, eventually I was released from the hospital and referred to a doctor who was a new type of asthma specialist. He had developed a creative way to treat the ailment, so I was sent to his clinic for further treatment. This photo of me with Dr. Elmer Gay was taken when I was 6 years old. Now, a closer look at the sign hanging over our head reveals that I actually went to the Gay Clinic in Biloxi, Mississippi. The treatment I received from Dr. Gay was experimental, and his staff recorded every detail of my case. And I came to appreciate medical science very much, but I recently learned that Dr. Gay was actually experimenting with arsenic. Apparently, I consumed arsenic for 5 years through the Gay Clinic. And I can say now that I was not poisoned by a church or religious doctrine. Unfortunately, I was poisoned by an avant-garde medical doctor. The problem was that my mother treated Dr. Gay as if he were a god, and she did not ask questions, and she followed every instruction. Her lack of inquiry allowed Dr. Gay to use me as a human lab animal. My mother followed Dr. Gay's every instruction and never asked, what was that red liquid that he prescribed? And I wouldn't have known about the arsenic poisoning had I not found that medical treatment sheet that you see on the screen. So I still suffer from serious asthma, and to this day, I must rely on medications and doctors and medical technology to stay alive. As an adult, however, I ask a lot of questions. Unlike my mother, I'm very fortunate to have developed critical thinking skills. A skeptical outlook actually helped me to survive a crazy childhood. I was the middle child in the family. The photo of me and my sisters was taken in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, where I was born. My half-sister Martha is pictured on the right side of this photo. She's 3 years older than me. And as you can see, Martha is a person of color. The little girl in the middle is my younger sister. In the 1950s and 60s, the state of Louisiana, well, most of the entire southern region of the United States, was overpopulated with bigots who promoted hatred against anyone who was not white. The prejudice I observed was based on the color of a person's skin, and signs saying so were everywhere. Martha's skin was a beautiful dark brown shade. My skin was comical. It was white with brown spots of various shapes and sizes, and I considered myself a polka dot child. And even as a young child, I noticed that my skin spots were the same color as Martha's beautiful brown skin. So I thought the only reason I wasn't 100% brown like Martha was that she and I were 3 years apart. I thought in time my brown spots would come to cover my entire body and I would finally look like Martha's sister. But of course this didn't happen. I also noticed that everyone in the South was obsessed with skin color. It turned out that skin color was the only answer to most of my childhood questions. I asked why Martha couldn't use the same drinking faucet. I asked why my sister couldn't go swimming with me. I asked why Martha had to sit in the back of streetcars and buses that we often used. But because the color of her skin answer never made sense to me, how could someone's skin color make them unworthy? Why couldn't my sister be treated equally? Even at a young age, I knew that the way my sister was being treated was just plain wrong. But the prejudices were so looming, we couldn't fight it. My sister was often chased by white children in the neighborhood, and I ran with her. The rocks that hit my sister hit me just as hard. And the word nigger was shouted at us by so-called southern ladies and gentlemen of good breeding. And if not shouted, the nasty word was whispered from twisted lips of hatred. I didn't fully understand why our family received snarls and looks of disdain and strange comments until I was about 6 years of age. And it was then that I realized the word was being used to throw insults at my sister Martha and my mother. My mother's Spanish heritage was considered just as vile as dark skin. Observing and experiencing this type of hatred caused me to crave justice for anyone who suffers abuses. And I think that's why, as an adult, I continue to passionately fight against bigotry and prejudice. I couldn't fight back as a child, but as an adult, I fight very passionately for my rights and the rights of others to live a happy and free life. By the time I was 8 years old, my parents divorced. My father suddenly went missing in the family unit. Mental illness and very poor adult decision-making skills threw us into poverty, and my mother struggled to even put food on the table. I was told that my father abandoned the family and didn't care. My father figure could not be counted on to help in any way. My father would not respond to any type of communication. And even though I knew he was out there somewhere, he chose not to send us money, food, or even a slight expression of love. If we wanted or needed anything, it was up to us to make it happen. I was sitting in church with my family when I realized that the people around me might as well be praying to my father figure. Their heavenly father was not responding to their prayers and pleas for help either. I saw no acts of love from their father figure. Tornadoes and hurricanes, earthquake, starvation, disease, and death are no acts of love from a heavenly father. So I concluded that the people sitting in the church simply did not realize what I realized. There is no such thing as a heavenly father. There is no such thing as a God. Well, during those stressful growing up years, my only escape was reading. After finding me rummaging through my neighbor's trash to retrieve discarded magazines, my mother decided that the family must somehow purchase and own our own books. Now, this was a difficult task because, according to my mother, we never received child support. All three of her children had to start working as soon as we were able, and there was no room in the family budget for extravagances such as books. Well, somehow we were able to purchase a full set of encyclopedias. So I started reading them every day, vowing to read the set from A to Z. And I loved those books. But even with all the comprehensive information I found in the encyclopedias, I continued to ask more questions. Unfortunately, my education and pursuit of knowledge were hampered by poverty. I was only about 10 when I started working odd jobs in the neighborhood. I started mending and sewing for neighbors and friends and family. And sewing made me very aware that hands clasped together in prayer are a waste of time. The very people who preach that idle hands are the devil's playground spent hours with their fingers clasped together, getting no work done for hours and hours. It was obvious to me that praying simply prevented real work from getting done. And sewing reinforced the fact that nothing can be accomplished when hands are praying. While my aunts and uncles fell to their knees begging an invisible God to provide jobs for them so that they could put food on the table, I was making clothes for pay. I recall one Sunday morning I told my mothers and sisters and aunts and uncles that I didn't want to go to church to pray and light candles. I told them that I had no sin to confess and I didn't want to take communion. Now, with a defiant stance, I pointed to a pile of sewing I had to do and asked them if repairing their clothes and making clothes for our neighbors was more important. Well, put that way, yes. When given that option, they agreed that it was best for me to stay home. So I started accepting every Sunday job I could get. Babysitting, sewing, cleaning houses, it didn't matter. Any excuse was good to stay out of church. But my Hispanic family firmly held on to their strong religious beliefs. And depending on which church was giving away food, their religious affiliations varied. We received many donations of food through local churches, and my mother changed religions accordingly. One month we were Methodists, and a few months later, mother would announce that we were Baptist. I learned all about phony claims of piety and religious hypocrisy from that experience. There were times when I couldn't find Sunday work, and the thought of learning about a new religion was of interest to me. I was always disappointed. Sitting in church with unanswerable questions in my head was almost intolerable. Going to church was like being inside the Twilight Zone. Everybody was acting so weird. Men wore dresses and hats. People were idolizing a dead man on a cross, and I was expected to pretend that I was eating a man's body and drinking his blood. The Hispanic culture is steeped in superstitious beliefs, even above and beyond those that are found in religion. My family believed in monsters and apparitions who would either protect you or do you harm. And it was thought that one must conduct a seance or use a Ouija board to find out which ghostly purpose prevailed in the house. From an early age, I concluded that seances and the use of a Ouija board are pure nonsense. But that conclusion did not stop me from having some fun. As a mischievous teen, it was fun to poke at people during a seance. And I would be the one responsible for making these seance participants scream out loud. You see, I had learned about the fuse box in the basement when a repair person was called in to fix a lighting problem. And I knew exactly which fuse to pull out for each room. And I never tired to make sure the ghost my relatives believed in showed them a sign. And during those weekly seances at our house, I also used a broom handle to tap on the flooring from the basement below. Oh, I loved that basement. It was my trickster's paradise. You know, I think that fooling gullible relatives actually gave me confidence. I also gained full knowledge that the world of the supernatural simply does not exist. As an adult, my humorous outlook concerning superstitions caused me to want to teach the value of rational thinking. So noticing the need to cure superstitions related to Friday the 13th and to teach rational thinking skills, I created a character I call the Frigatrisca Decaphobia Treatment Nurse. And I bring that character to life every Friday the 13th to cure people of their fears about bad luck, black cats, mirrors, ladders, and a whole host of silly superstitions. The goal is to substitute magical thinking with skepticism and rationality. Now, while common superstitions are really harmless, some people actually make life-changing decisions determined by the alignment of the stars and if the number 13 happens to fall on a Friday. Every Friday the 13th, the economy is affected when people avoid making purchases and investments and traveling, or even going to work on Friday the 13th. And I say that people should not restrict themselves from traveling, investing, making purchases, or working on that day due to superstitions. But in difficult times, some people just need to think there's a magical formula to guide them or that a God is looking out for them. They need to imagine a better place than the one in which they live. It's just too difficult for some to realize that in the natural world, bad things do happen to good people, and good things do happen to bad people. Nature doesn't make determinations for rewards or punishments. The natural world is filled with uncontrollable circumstances. Negative and beneficial consequences of our behavior, the choices we make, and the situations we find ourselves in, well, for the most part, they are unpredictable. All we have is our common sense and some probability factors to guide us through our lives. We are the only caretakers in the here and the now. Being poor and needy caused me to work hard for the things that I needed and wanted. Exposure to prejudice made me determined to never be victimized. Now, many of you in this room know about my 9-year lawsuit against the Boy Scouts of America, but very few of you know that my first encounter with the Boy Scouts of America took place when I was about 10 years old. My family lived in an old Victorian home located next to the Hollywood Freeway in Los Angeles, California. The house was filled with aunts and uncles who had just arrived from Puerto Rico, and the home was directly across the alley from the Boy Scouts of America's Los Angeles Council building. The Boy Scout building was surrounded by a high wire fence, and just inside the gate, beyond the grass, my sisters and I could see sports equipment, a basketball court, a tetherball pole, and a huge white dodgeball circle. One day, I asked the scout leader if my sisters and I could use the equipment and the playground. I pleaded my case, saying that I lived right across the alley from the building. But the scout leader laughed at my approach and patted me on the head and said, "Sweetheart, this is a club for boys. We don't even allow girls on the playground. Now go back and play with your dolls." I returned home, but I told my mother that I thought it was completely unfair and mean of the Boy Scouts to keep us away from the playground, and I demanded that she go and talk to that scout leader. Well, she did. She marched over to the Boy Scout building, and when she returned, she announced that we were all invited to work at the facility, but we could never use the playground. Well, any work for pay was a huge step forward in my family because no adult spoke English very well. The language barrier had been a huge detriment for all of us to find jobs. The job we took as a family was cooking and serving and cleaning up after the Boy Scouts' special occasions. We actually worked the night the event that's highlighted in the badge that you see on the slide. And even as a 10-year-old, I worked as a dishwasher and server. After working several events, my sisters and I decided that we had earned the right to use the playground and the sports equipment. We would watch for the times when the office was closed and there was no activity on the playground. As often as we could, we would scale the 7-foot-high fence and we played until dusk. I loved the fact that I could outwit authority and enjoy the same things that boys could enjoy. My half-sister and I were violating the rules, which were reminiscent of the same segregation rules of the South. There was no guilt, just a great deal of satisfaction. My half-sister was 13 at the time, and the invasion plan we schemed was our way of dealing with and overcoming unfair bigotry. And I still recall the delightful feeling I had when I was forced to work for those smug Boy Scout leaders. They had no idea that I was getting my girly fingerprints all over their sports equipment and the boys' only playground. Now jump ahead 35 years and I had to deal with Boy Scout bigotry all over again. In 1991, my son was thrown out of the Boy Scouts because he was from a non-theist home. I was propelled into activism, defending his right to participate in a supposedly open to the public organization. The story about my struggle with the Boy Scouts caught the attention of the publisher of Parenting Beyond Belief, and I'm very, very proud to be included in that book. I think the experience taught my son a wonderful lesson about civil rights, and I know he fully understands the necessity of ending negative stereotyping and unfounded bigotry. While religious parents read the David and Goliath story to children to teach about finding strength to fight a gigantic problem, our family lived through a real life encounter. I've never been afraid to question authority, but I was always curious about what happened to my father. I visited him in Studio City, California, and during our visit, he gave me a box of items that he kept. In the box was my original baptism certificate. Coincidentally, I was planning a trip to Italy that year. So I took my baptismal records with me on the trip. And standing in the middle of St. Peter's Square, I tore my certificate into four pieces. My husband took this photograph of me doing the deed. I sent this photo, the torn pieces of the baptismal certificate, and a two-page letter to the Pope requesting that my name be taken off of church records. Yeah, okay. Well, 6 months later, I received a beautiful ivory linen envelope that looked like a wedding invitation. It was sealed with wax and had gold embossed lettering. The Pope's office spared no expense. When I opened the envelope, I saw a red silk ribbon and the same gold lettering that was used on the outside of the envelope. And I smiled as I read, "His Holiness acknowledges your recent correspondence." And I fantasize how upsetting my leaving the church was to the Pope. Now, even though that letter did not specifically say that I was excommunicated, I know that my request was received and at least acknowledged. In my letter to the Pope, I disclosed that I had read the Bible cover to cover. And I contend that if people who claim to be religious actually read the Bible, they would end up being atheists. And I have the same opinion about reading the Quran cover to cover, because priests and ministers and reverends and mullahs and imams who spoon-feed selected excerpts from their so-called holy books to these lazy believers is what probably is keeping religion alive. Staying unaware of all the holy book contradictions and stories about rape and murder and war and slavery will keep the religious community happily ignorant. I've disdained absurd Bible stories and religious authority since I was 13. And it was at that age that I had the great honor to know a man named Floyd Kanai. He was married to my mother's friend, and we called him Uncle Floyd because he became a fond part of our family. He would always say, "Look that up, Margaret," every time I went to him with a question. He'd say, "Look it up and tell me what you think about that Bible story or that little bit of information. Study the facts, then come to me with the evidence, and then we'll talk." And time again, I would tell Uncle Floyd that the Bible was filled with nonsense. One day, after hearing me ridicule the Bible story of Noah and the flood, Uncle Floyd laughed and said, "Well, Margaret, you think that way because you're an atheist." And he went on to tell me that he was an atheist too. And then he gave me Bertrand Russell's book, Why I'm Not a Christian. And I loved that book because it was as if Bertrand Russell had crawled into my head and he wrote everything that I was thinking. Now, my Uncle Floyd died of a heart attack when I was 16. That was September 4th, 1966. But he would have loved to have seen me grow up to be an atheist leader. I'm so sure of that. After Uncle Floyd revealed that he was an atheist, and after I read that why I'm not a Christian, I really never hesitated to talk about my non-theist conclusions. But I recall the first time I actually publicly exposed myself as an out atheist. You see, I was an interior designer for 20 years before becoming an atheist activist. On December 15th, 1985, I was asked to speak to a women's group about window treatments and the general topic of decorating. Well, I accepted the invitation, and I was told that the women's group met at the local Catholic church. Oh, no problem. It was not like they were asking me to be Catholic. So when I arrived to the Catholic church, I was told that the women's group I was scheduled to address was in session with the parish priest. The women did work at the church, and the priest was taking more time than usual giving them his directions for the work that needed to be done that week. So I was told to sit down and wait. And as I sat on that little wood bench, I looked around the church and I realized that I had not been in a Catholic church since I was about 17. You see, I was forced to see a priest at age 17 because I had become pregnant just before my high school graduation. And my high school sweetheart, well, he was Catholic. I was told that the priest might concede to allow us to marry if we visited with him and if we proved that we were worthy of his blessing. And being a pregnant teenager was really scary, so I agreed to the visit, even though I thought there might be trouble. The priest told us right away that we were sinners and that the baby inside me was also a sinner. He yelled at us and attempted to make us feel regret and humbleness. And when he told us that we needed to attend marriage classes, I asked, "Well, who teaches those classes?" "I do," he said. I looked him in the eyes and I said, "But priests aren't even allowed to get married. How can you possibly give us advice?" He stood up and he pointed to the door and he said, "Get out, you sinners." Well, I got up and I said, "By the way, I'm an atheist and I never wanted to get married in this lousy church anyway." I turned to leave, but I threw one more comment at the priest, "And my baby is not a sinner." Well, I don't know if my rear end felt the back of the door or the priest's foot, but I was just happy to get away and at least tell him off in some way. Okay, so back to the night I was delivering the decorating presentation to the Catholic women's group. The door to the meeting room came open and my host, Rosalind, stepped out, and she reeked of cigar smoke. Rosalind said, "The priest wants to hear your presentation to make sure he approves of what you tell us." And I was absolutely shocked at this notion, and I countered with, "Well, who's in that room smoking a cigar?" She said, "Oh, that's Father O'Malley. He smokes a cigar." And I told her that I would not deliver my presentation in a smoke-filled room and that the priest could stay as long as he extinguished his cigar. Well, my host turned pale and she looked scared, but she returned to the meeting room to deliver my message. And a few minutes later, the door came open and Rosalind stepped out and she still looked scared. She said that the priest was upset with me, but that the ladies had convinced him to extinguish the cigar. So I waited purposely, let the room air out a bit, but I entered lugging my fabric samples and my shade samples, and the priest didn't even get up to introduce himself or make an offer to help me come in with my presentation materials. He just sat there staring at us with his arms crossed over his big belly. Well, a few minutes into my presentation, the priest left. I guess the subject of decorating was not that interesting. At any rate, I was glad to see him go. The ladies had been so timid and tense with him in the room. His arrogance was intimidating to everyone. During the question and answer portion of my presentation, one of the ladies asked me if I had any new and interesting ideas about how to decorate for Christmas. And without even thinking, I said, "Oh, I don't celebrate Christmas. I'm an atheist." And there was an audible gasp. I thought half the audience was going to faint, and I suddenly wished that the priest was still in the room. Now, slowly, some of the ladies leaned forward, and one lady in a half whisper said, "Tell us why you're an atheist." Well, truthfully, I had never contemplated explaining atheism or my journey to freedom of thought. The opportunity caught me off guard, so I told the ladies that because the priest had taken so long, I was out of time. But I told them that they could schedule me again for a presentation specifically about atheism. But most of the ladies just huffed and left the room. They wanted nothing to do with my blasphemous declaration. I was never invited back, and I'm sure the priest would not have allowed that subject to be discussed in his church. Did you want to show that other slide? Yeah, that's it. So when I wrote about a near-death experience and I was published on the internet, Dr. Andrew Newberg contacted me. He was writing a book about the subject of near-death, and he wanted to include an atheist experience. Yes, I almost died in 1978. I was rushed into emergency surgery, but a very important fact had not been disclosed to the nurses in the recovery room. I had eaten that day, which, as many of you know, is very deadly in the process of surgical recovery. I was experiencing suffocation when I floated above the room, and I saw the nurses looking at a magazine and laughing while a woman was choking and grasping for breath. And I turned to look at the woman in the bed, and the woman was me. And it was at that moment that a bright light beckoned me to travel towards it. And there at the end of the light was my Uncle Floyd. He held up his hand and he said, "Go back. You have work to do." And I wrote to the nurses, feverishly trying to save my life, and obviously I survived. Seeing my dead uncle did not cause me to become spiritual or religious, but it did cause me to do research in the phenomenon known as near-death experience. My need to know was really more of a tribute to my Uncle Floyd, who had always told me, "Look it up, learn the facts, look at the evidence, and then talk to me later." So I looked up near-death experience. Today, I highly recommend the book Dying to Live, written by Susan Blackmore, should you want to learn more about the near-death experience. The Blackmore book was not written when I did my research about near-death experience. There was no internet in 1978. I read everything I could find in the library, however, and I learned that chemicals are released in the brain that create the same dying experience in every human being. And I also learned the facts about what happens when the brain is denied oxygen for a dangerous amount of time. While some associate this natural phenomenon as walking towards heaven, I know that the human body is chemically capable of making the death experience less painful and perhaps even a peaceful end. The lack of oxygen going to the brain creates that tunnel of light. And seeing a dead loved one in your mind is actually accepting the fact that you too shall soon be dead. The vision appears as the dying process progresses. Now, as a consequence of this experience, I'm not afraid to die. I know that it will be a gentle and natural phenomenon. Uncle Floyd did not actually deliver the message to me in that near-death experience. It was my brain telling me to go back to work. And there is an awful lot of work to do. As I told you earlier, fighting prejudice and bigotry is a lifelong passion for me. Surveys show that non-theists are the most hated and misunderstood minority in America. We're not hated because of the color of our skin. We're hated because of our thought process and the conclusion that we reached that there is no God. Telling our journey stories can help end myths and in negative stereotyping of the non-theist community. So I hope many of you are inspired to do just that. Thanks for listening to my journey story.